Thank you. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you this day our brother Jim. We thank you for giving him to us, his family and friends, to know and to love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see in death the gate of eternal life, so that in quiet confidence we may continue our course on earth until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Welcome all. Please be seated. We are here today to grieve the death and celebrate the life of Jim Henson. He most especially requested that this be a happy occasion, and therefore asked that people could avoid wearing black. Well, it seems that's happened quite well. This is my Jim Henson shirt. I bought this the day I decided I was going to look just like him. But someone else decided to look even more like him. Kermit Green. If you can find that at Barney's, I'll be surprised. Janie Henson said, "Let there be flowers." I'm sorry they couldn't find too many, but it is that time of the year. You'll see flowers everywhere celebrating the life of all of us and the life that God shares with us. At this point in time, we do ask one thing. The love and the understanding and the cooperation. You learned that on Sesame Street, I know. In respecting this moment, we have, all of us, seen pictures and videos of all the Muppets and all the people around here before. Please take it into your hearts to try to refrain from taking any pictures or any videos during this special service. You know, it's funny how Jim and his Muppets crept into our lives so slowly over 35 years. So much so that we all took them very much for granted, in the very best way. Very much like our families or the trees and flowers that fill our world. Henson's Muppets spoke to the part of kids that was grown up, and to the part of grown-ups that was childlike. I want to read a couple of things from quotes from kids who had grown up on Sesame Street, who were asked about the loss of Jim and the reaction they had to him. One babysitter said she was taking care of a child who was not easy to handle. She put him down in front of Sesame Street and the kid sat down mesmerized. She says, "I flopped down beside him. Slowly I witnessed the transformation from holy terror to little angel." She says, I mean, things change and all, but the Muppets, well, they were always there. Another kid says, "They mean a lot to me. They taught me to use my imagination. Sesame Street helped me to be nice to others, even if they were bigger or smaller, or even looked different." Another says, "My favorite Muppet is Cookie Monster. He makes me feel good about myself and the other Muppets." Another one said, "Kermit taught me leadership. He is friendly and fair, qualities a leader needs." Another says, "When I was younger, all his characters were idols of mine, and they taught me right from wrong. His shows helped build my character and personality with kindness and honesty." The last says, "After seeing pigs and frogs that could speak and dance, I remember thinking anything was possible." During this time, millions of children were watching Sesame Street. The rest of the world was watching Muppet Show. It was interesting. All over the world, people changed their dinner hours accordingly to when it was shown in their local station. Pubs in England would shift their opening hours. In the Eastern Bloc of Europe, I've been told by people who've come over now that when the Muppet Show was on, the streets of Czechoslovakia and Yugoslavia were empty. The one place they could escape to from the hard times they were having then was through the magic of Jim and his friends. Another thing, a friend of mine just came back from Sumatra. It seemed that on the day that Jim was leaving us, he was in a tiny village called Bukittinggi, Sumatra, way, way over the other side of the big pond. It was a Muslim tribe called the Manan Kabal. They have one TV in their village. And as Jim was leaving us, all the adults and all the children of this village sat around this TV watching Muppet Show and laughing at what Jim had left them. And now as you hear from Jim speaks, I'm sorry, and now as you hear Jim's friends speak or sing, listen. Listen closely. Sometimes you will laugh. Sometimes you will cry. Always you will feel the warmth of Jim's heart. And in this special atmosphere, we will sort of breathe in his air one more time.
My name is Jerry Jewell, and I'm a writer for the Muppets. I started writing for the Muppets in September of 1961. And at the time, at that point in my life, I had just barely managed to graduate from college. Jim, about the same age at that time, had also just barely managed to graduate from college and had, in his spare time, utterly transformed the art of puppetry. It had already happened by the time I got there. The day I walked in the door, Kermit the Frog was there, although he wasn't called a frog in those days. And there were drawers full of little cloth, flexible puppets that didn't look like animals and didn't look like people. They were just Muppets. And already Jim had taken the puppets out of the puppet stage and started to float them in the space that the television camera created. So that by 1961, all the basic work had been done, and all that made everything that followed possible. In later years, Jim always liked to say that he didn't get into puppetry as an end in itself, but as a means to working in film and television. But of course, working in film and television isn't an end in itself either. I think what Jim really wanted to do was to sing songs and tell stories, teach children, promote peace, save the planet, celebrate man, praise God, and be silly. For those of us who were caught up in his vision, the silliness was really important. If you doubt that, take a look at Steve Whitmire's suit tonight. Here's my favorite story about Jim Henson, with apologies to those of you to whom I have told it too many times. It was in the middle of the Muppet Show years, and I was ending a very long, hard day and just putting on my coat when my office door flew open and in loped Jim Henson with a script in his hand. He was having problems with a certain sketch in next week's show. So I got out the script and I looked at the offending pages. Now, I have to tell you that Jim was not always immediately articulate when it came to discussing scripts. And so, as was so typical of script meetings with Jim, there was a lot of paper flipping and pencil tapping as we looked at this piece of material. Now, the very centerpiece of this sketch was a joke. It was a pun. It was a really silly pun. It was the kind of pun that wore clown makeup and carried a whoopee cushion. It was really quite an appalling piece of work. And I was really worried about bringing up this pun because I knew that if we lost that joke, we'd lose the whole sketch and I'd have to take off my coat and go back to work. So we flipped and we tapped for a while. And finally I decided that it was time to bite the bullet. And I said, Jim, is it this central joke that bothers you? And he laughed and he said, oh no, it's a terrible joke, but it's worthy of us. And that's the way I'll always remember Jim Henson, as a man who was balanced effortlessly and quite elegantly between the sacred and the silly. Thanks, Jim.
Touches the valley, all the clouds are taught to fly. Thus our souls will leave this land most peacefully. Though our minds be filled with questions, in our hearts we'll understand. When the river meet the sea, like a flower that has blossomed in a dry and barren sand, we are born and born again most gracefully. Thus the winds of time will take us with a sure and steady hand, when the river meets the sea. Patience, my brothers, and patience, my son, in that sweet and final hour, truth and justice will be. What a newborn baby dreams is a mystery, but his life will find a purpose, and in time he'll understand when the river meets the sea. When the river meets the almighty sea.
I am Allie Lou Curtin, General Secretary of UNIMA USA, an international organization of puppeteers. I am also a puppeteer, asked here as a representative of puppeteers the world over, for whom Jim Henson was an inspiration, an advocate, and a friend. My last few weeks were spent at international festivals and conferences with puppeteers from many countries. In the last few days, all gave tribute to Jim. In the performance spaces of the International Children's Theater Festivals, the performers honored him with words and with moments of silence. A Japanese friend said many people imitated his style, but no one could capture the spirit, that animated it. Friends spoke of the spin-off of his art, not only in puppetry, but in theater, in stagecraft of all kinds, in film, always developing new techniques. Everyone spoke of his generosity and of his humanity. We celebrate Jim Henson, puppeteer. He gave new dignity to our art form. People speak of the universal language of puppetry. Jim gave it a new vocabulary, and his puppets spoke that language with kindness, with humor, and above all, with heart. He was puppeteers and our country's most effective ambassador. His values positive, his Muppets fun and off the wall, provoking smiles and laughter from hundreds of millions of people the world over. An American puppeteer said, "How amazing that one of the most incredible human beings on earth is a frog." Jim was unchanged by success. I never knew anyone who had such a quality of attention and concern. He had respect for every human being, and he respected the artist's right to be himself. He had made his own personal statement in puppetry, and his Henson Foundation and his many personal contributions gave other puppeteers the same possibility. But his generosity wasn't ordinary philanthropy. Jim was first and foremost a puppeteer. Puppetry was his passion. He served as president of the Puppeteers of America, president of UNIMA USA, and he honored the puppeteers who went before him while nurturing and listening to the young puppeteers. He loved puppets and puppetry so much that he felt joy and interest in every aspect of it. He showed us the amazing potential of puppets to teach, to heal, to inspire, with the added message that education should be imaginative and entertaining. Jim helped nurture all of our dreams. He was proud that centers of puppetry arts were growing up all over the country, and he lent them his presence whenever possible. He was concerned about the teaching of puppetry, the conferences and festivals that promoted puppetry, and especially puppetry on a professional level. Wanting puppetry in our country to take its place as a serious art form for adult audiences, his Henson Foundation encouraged the unique vision of countless innovative artists. Most important, he never asked that the work be of a certain persuasion or even that he himself like it. He once said to me in connection with the UNIMA Citations for Excellence in the Art of Puppetry, which he helped to put in place, "If people I respect think it has merit, it has, regardless of my personal opinion." Jim Henson encouraged people to work together positively for the promotion of puppetry. He always made a point of acknowledging the creative teamwork of the Henson Associates and the nurturing of creative ideas that went on within it. It was typical of Jim and the whole Henson organization that 117 East 69th Street focused on a spiral staircase and a doors open policy so that all those involved in the work could communicate easily and openly. He thought of the whole world of puppetry that way, as a connected spiral, as a synergy in all its aspects, and the members of that global family of puppeteers all felt his concern. We work together in his spirit. Jim, with his vision, his humanity, his love of puppetry, leaves a great legacy, an organization of countless friends with whom he worked, enlivened by his spirit. All of us here and everywhere who love and believe in puppetry, we are, in the best sense, inheritors of his concern. Above all, he leaves the Henson family. Jane, who from the first has been a partner of Jim's work and vision, and Lisa, Cheryl, Brian, John, and Heather, all people of the heart. Jim's spirit in puppetry, in life, in heart, goes on in them, and pray God in all of us. Thank you, Jim.
Most of you here today, I'm sure, are Americans, and you think of Jim Henson as American. Well, I'm here to tell you that Jim Henson was English. And okay, to the Poles, he was Polish, and to the Japanese, he was Japanese. He belonged to the whole world, but in particular, he was ours. He spent more than 10 years living in London. All the Muppet shows were made there, 4 movies, specials, The Storyteller. And the creature shop that he loved is there too, in an old Victorian post office, 20 feet from the front door of his house in Hampstead. It was in London too, in 1981, that Jim sat us down, set us the task of creating a TV series that would end war in the world. Of course, we all fell on the floor. But then we picked ourselves up because he was quite serious. He was serious about change. The series was Fraggle Rock, and it hasn't stopped war. It hasn't changed the world. But it says something about the man that his intentions were so big and so simple. He didn't say, let's make a show that will win its time slot. Some of you might think that as much a curse as a blessing. But nevertheless, his creations were translated into dozens of languages, Finnish, Mandarin, Serbo-Croatian. Fraggle Rock was loved in India. He made a special in Moscow. I remember being in Baghdad to supervise dubbing Ernie into Arabic. The Storyteller was seen by 400 million people in China. But it's not the statistics that are significant. It's, of course, the unique quality of a man whose work was truly above nation, above language, above creed. Jim had time for everyone, sometimes a frustrating amount of time. He was hard to travel with, jeopardizing a flight to sign an autograph, holding up shooting to listen to the ideas of a stagehand. He was available to anybody and anything, undemanding, yet asking for the world, offering space, but making it impossible to take a vacation. It could drive you crazy. Even when he was alive, he was as much a spirit as a person. And he had to be. His family, his company was all over the world. And he found a way of being with us all, always. His spirit informed companies, crews. Even when Jim wasn't physically there, there was this Henson thing, this signature. Hard to define, but very real, in the corridors of our offices, on the sets of our shows. All my working life, I've been with the Muppets, 17 years. First at CTW here in New York, then for the past 11 years with Jim in London. My job interview all that time ago was a walk on Hampstead Heath, stopping on Parliament Hill, high over London, one of Jim's special places, where he'd put a bench in memory of his friend Don Saleen. The talk we had continued over dinner, then into a conversation which stretched over a decade. I know that when Jim sat on Don's bench, he looked out not over London, but over the whole world. When Jim died last week, he was mourned deeply in England as one of ours, and I'm sure in Poland and Japan as one of theirs. As Anthony Minghella wrote in London on Wednesday, Jim will be missed by millions who might not know his name or his face, but would instantly recognize his voice and the wide green smile of his most memorable creation. Impossible to think him gone. Better to imagine him traveling, as he did ceaselessly, from country to country, from welcome to welcome.
There is no question about Jim Henson's great artistry and the extent to which we have all been touched by it. But greater than his artistry was his humanity. And unless You have moved among the wretched of the earth. Unless you have spent countless hours on the reservations of this country that house the Native Americans and the Indians who live out hopeless lives on their reservations, unless you've moved among those who live in ghettos contained by segregation and deprivation, unless you have moved among vast peoples who sit on continents that are still struggling for their human rights and their dignity, unless you have sat among tribes who care for children that face an existence of hopelessness, you will never really understand Jim Henson until you've understood how he has touched the lives of those people. Many have no hope. Many mothers sit in many places holding their children, desperately understanding that they will never be educated. They will never have a chance at life as it should be. And when they get a chance to see the smile on the faces of their children, as they develop the appetite to learn because they're watching Sesame Street, when they have developed the appetite to love in a loveless place because they have seen how friendly the Muppets and the creatures are to one another, when they find their own humanity and the humanity of these creations, then you'll have understood the real gift of Jim Henson and his colleagues. I say this because I have moved among those people, and I have seen in these wretched places smiles break out on faces that have never been familiar with the cause of smile and have come to life and have been touched in a profound way because Jim Henson said, there is hope, there is joy, there is the ability to love and to care and to find greatness in difference. That is the Jim Henson that I think most of us who have had the opportunity to serve with him, and in some instances even to serve him, that is the legacy that I think we carry with us. And when I first came to Jim with a song that was created from one of those wretched places that spoke to the hopes and to the thoughts and the feelings of a mythology that I didn't know that most people would want to even hear about, it was Jim who said, let's do it. And he showed me that there was, in fact, a greater humanity than I ever understood when I worked with those faces and those people and those Muppets who challenged me on so many levels and kept me in touch with my own humanity. The song we're about to do was a gift to Jim from a peoples who come from a continent where gifts are not common. And he turned it into a celebration and sent it back as a gift from him. We come from the fire, living in the fire. Go back to the fire, turn the world around. We come from the fire, living in the fire. Go back to the fire, turn the world around. We come from the fire, living in the fire. Go back to the fire, turn the world around. Around. We come from
around. We come from the water, living in the water. Go back to the water, turn the world around. Come from the mountain, living on the mountain. Go back to the mountain, turn the world around. We come from the mountain, living on the mountain. Go back to the mountain, turn the world around. We come from the mountain, living on the mountain. Go back to the mountain, turn the world around. Whoa, so is life. Whoa, so is life. Whoa, so is life. Whoa, so is life. Do you know who I am? Do I know who you are? See we one another clearly. Do we know who we are? Do you know who I am? Do I know who you are? See we one another clearly. Do we know who we are? Do you know who I am? Do I know who you are? See we one another clearly. Do we know who we are? Whoa, so is life a body. Whoa, so is life. Whoa, so is life a body. Whoa, so is life. Wash the mountain, fire make the sunlight, turn the world around. Heart is of the river, body is the mountain, spirit is the sunlight, turn the world around. We are of the spirit, truly of the spirit, the spirit, turn the world around. We are of the spirit, truly of the spirit, only can the spirit turn the world around. Do you know who I am? Do I know? See we one another clearly. Do we know who we are? Do you know who I am? Do I know who you are? See we one another clearly. Do we know who we are? Do you know who I am? Do I know who you are? See we one another clearly. Do we know who we are? Whoa, so is life about you. Whoa, so is life. Whoa, so so is life. Whoa, so is life. 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 So is life.
Hello, I'm Frank Oz. Jim and I were opposites in so many ways. I think it worked mainly because of his patience and understanding, that which we had together, both personally and in performance, and then the creative partnership that I shared with him and others. I knew, not all the time, but in the last 15 years or so, that he was a very singular human being. Looking here, I think I only realize now how large a man this was, this man that I just worked with and played with and had so much fun with. And we did have fun. We had such great silly fun together. The best thing of all, the best thing is when you watch Jim laugh until he cried. It usually happened when we were recording something or performing with the gang, and Jim would, I don't know, we'd get so punchy and silly at 2 a.m, and Jim would just start that high whine, and he couldn't speak, and the tears are rolling down, and he'd try to add to the joke, and he just couldn't do it, and it was the best thing to see, because you knew he was always busy and always working and pressure and thinking. It was such a purge and a release. It was wonderful. The best thing to see him do that. I can't tell you how much he supported me. I joined when I was 19, 27 years ago. And he's given me the most amazing opportunities. And he's taught me so much just by being the person who he is. It's very important to me. There's so much to tell. Let me just zero in on one little thing. About 15 years ago, we were doing Saturday Night Live, the first year of Saturday Night Live. Jim and I and a few others of the gang were doing some puppets there. And it was before Christmas. And it was just prior to dress rehearsal. The other guys had gone away to have lunch or something. So Jim and I were hanging around the halls. And as I recall, it was the hallway, Jim came up with a camera. And he said in his own quiet, enthusiastic way, he said, Frank, I need to go in the dressing room with you, and if you could take off all your clothes so I could take a picture of you naked. I said, whoa. I said, what? He said, I really need to do this. I need to take some photos of you naked. We discussed this for a while. I said, okay. All right. So we went in the dressing room, and I took off all my clothes, buck naked. Locked the door, of course. And he told me how to pose. He said, put your hands over your genitals, which I was glad to do. Bend over like this and look into the camera in a state of shock, which was not difficult at that time. So I bent over and I looked like that, and he took some photos of me naked. Okay, no problem. I got dressed, we did the show. It was Christmas time. He gave me a gift. The gift was about this large, I have it. And the gift, I'll describe it to you, it's difficult. It's more like made of some of Bert's toys, and it was a wall hanging sculpture kind of thing, about this big. And it was a head of Bert. And Bert's arms are holding a ledge. And on the ledge are about a dozen little Berts, tiny Berts, you can buy in the stores at that time, about 1.5 inches high. And you could turn them in different directions, looking over there, and looking back at the big Bert's head while the big Bert was looking down at the little Berts. And on that ledge, underneath the Berts, were faces, photographs that Jim obviously took of many of the shop people, the workshop people, several of which were responsible in the making of Bert, and certainly all of which were responsible in the making of the Muppets. And they were all looking up the camera, and their little faces, about that big, all along the top of the ledge. On the edge of this wooden ledge, Jim had painted layers, like earth striations, which were really, I gather, layers of Bert's mind, layers of his soul. By the way, I do Bert to Jim's Ernie. And within those layers, the striations, he painted textures, beautiful little textures. And then I noticed Bert's eyes, the large Bert's eyes, the pupils were cut out. And you look inside Bert's brain, and there I am, naked, looking at this. I knew he had a good reason. I say that to share that with you. Oh, by the way, he entitled it Bert in Self-Contemplation. I share it with you because so much of Jim is in that gift. The detail that he loved so much, Persian rugs and trees and life, the detail in the layers, the textures, he had so much fun. I just see him hunched over, real gleeful, giggling, doing this. And I could see him just cutting those little photos out so he doesn't cut the ears or the nose off of the photo people, and he pasted them on himself. And the generosity of time in order to do this when he was so busy, the generosity of taking the time to do it, and not only the giving of the gift, but the anticipation of giving. I can't tell you so many times Jim would say to me, oh, I can't wait to give this gift to Janie or Brian or Davey or whoever. The anticipation of giving was so wonderful with Jim. And the complexity of that gift, Bert looking at himself, me inside, the little Bert's looking all around, the complexity, the inwardness of that, and the simplicity of the concept was also Jim. And the quality of the gift, and the craftsmanship, it all speaks so much of Jim, that gift. And I think the love, I think that's what I knew. He loved me and I love him.
Find it, the rainbow connection. My name is John Stone. I'm a writer and director. I don't remember exactly how Jim and I met. I know it was in 1963 or 64, but from the moment we met, we were never very far apart. That happened to a lot of people. More and more of us joined Jim's extended family over the years, beginning with the pre-Sesame Street people, Jane, Frank, the two Jerrys, Don Celine, those guys. And then he drew the Sesame Street group into his orbit, and then the Muppet Show and Fraggle Rock and all the designers and builders and writers and puppeteers. And what is most remarkable is that for the most part, we all knew each other and we really liked each other. The early hours of May 16th were a waking nightmare. One by one, all of us heard the unhearable, and we must all have had the same first reaction. This is an epic mistake. But it seems that everyone's second thought was for the rest of us in the family. My phone rang all that day, and that night, and all the next day. The calls were from you, each of you hurting so much, and knowing that I must be hurting that much too. So you called just to see if I was all right, and to try to take some of my pain away, and maybe to gain a little strength from the sound of my voice. And I called you because I needed to hear you, because I wanted to try to make your hurt not quite so painful. It is no accident that you loving, talented, caring people wound up in Jim Henson's family. I loved Jim very much, and I love you very much too.
Not that easy being green, having to spend the day the color of the leaves, when I think it could be nicer being red or yellow or gold or something much more colorful like that. It's not easy being green. It seems you blend in with so many other ordinary things, and people tend to pass you over, 'cause you're not standing out like flashy sparkles on the water or stars in the sky. But green is the color of spring, and green can be cool and friendly like. And green can be big like a mountain, or tall as a tree, or as a sea. When green is all there is to be, it could make you wonder why. But why wonder? Why wonder? I am green, and it'll do fine. It's beautiful, and I think it's what I want to be. Thank you, Kermit.
Jim told me never to follow the bird. I'm Bernie Brillstein, and I've been Jim's friend and manager for 30 years. In a business where the one who shouts the loudest usually gets the most attention, Jim Henson rarely spoke above a whisper. You had to lean in to hear him most of the time, but it was always worth the effort. David Laser and I knew how loud his whisper was. He was a man with a vision, and though his greatest appeal was to the simplest of human emotions, the purest of ideas, he was not above using the most advanced technological means to achieve his goal. My friend Jim was by most definitions a genius, but not like Edison suggested. Edison said genius was 1% inspiration and 99% perspiration. With Jim, I think it was about 50-50. His ability to create whole worlds of people and things is well documented, and we'll have that legacy forever. But after coming up with the concept, he'd work tirelessly on every phase of the process to see that it was the best it could possibly be. As a rule, perfectionists are a real pain. They drive the people around them crazy in their single-minded search for excellence. But Jim inspired people to be better than they thought they could be, to be more creative, more daring, more outrageous, and ultimately more successful. And he did it all without raising his voice. That whisper will stay with all of us for a long time. Now we'll just have to listen a little harder to hear it.
don't worry, Bernie. They just called. The other meeting ran a little over. He's in the car. He'll be about 15 minutes late. So, don't you all keep expecting that call? We were told that we would have to introduce ourselves, and so I figured, okay, I can probably handle the name part, but then what? So then I thought I might as well do it the way Jim usually did, which went something like, this is Michael Frith, who sort of heads up one of our sort of creative groups and sort of does a lot of our design stuff. It usually came as a kind of question, and for close to a couple of decades, it's been hanging there waiting for an answer. You see, Jim didn't like to define those things too closely, not, I think, because he didn't understand what people did, but because he always believed they were capable of so much more. And why not? The length and strength of his own talents is so astonishing. Writer, artist, designer, director, producer, with an absolutely staggering list of credits. We once figured that we were active in every single medium extant, except maybe radio. Bernie? But what the world will always remember and treasure is his genius for wiggling the dollies. For that's what it all came down to, doll wiggling. What an extraordinary discipline. Most of you, I'm sure, know the great Gonzo, the probable offspring of an illicit liaison between a nearsighted turkey and a pencil sharpener, whose idea of art is juggling two grand pianos while reciting Trees and dancing in a vat of oatmeal. And the Muppet performers would have us believe that this kind of behavior is odd. Compared to what they do, it's a walk to the grocery store. There's a scene in The Dark Crystal where the two young leads, Jen and Kira, are floating in a little boat down an idyllic stream through a bucolic countryside while Kira sings a haunting song as Jen accompanies her on his flute. Idyllic and bucolic, it appeared to be on the screen, but the true picture would have had Gonzo's heart thumping with envy. Jim and Kathy Mullen, playing Jen and Kira, were crunched in fetal positions between the cold, wet bilges of a barge and the bottom of Kira's boat, television monitors on their chests, cables snaking all around, over and under them, technicians' feet in their faces, and their arms thrust up into their circulation-numbing puppets. And as frogmen towed the top-heavy menage back and forth for take after take, I heard Kathy's voice in anguished acknowledgement of it all waft across the water. Why is this so damn hard? And Jim's reply, calm, matter of fact, and inevitable, because if it wasn't, everybody would be doing it. And I believe, in a way, he believed that. Everybody can do everything, and every attempt is an adventure. The work had to be as good as it could possibly be. That was his gift to us all, an assurance that we could reach down just a little deeper and come back with something astonishing, not only to the world, but to ourselves. Brian Henson has given us a wonderful quote from Jim that's printed in your order of worship. It's full of thoughts of forgiveness, thanks, and love. And these, Jim, we are gathered here today to give back to you. Jim, for all those meetings that ran just a little late and left squads of people chasing you down the sidewalk for that approval on just the right shade of shocking pink hair, we forgive you. For all those times around the conference table when, with 20 pairs of hopeful eyes fixed on you for some vital answer to some essential question, and you replied, "Gee, I'm feeling really wishy-washy about that." We forgive you. From all the stitchers and doodlers, sculptors and writers, actors, composers and tinkerers into whose hands you put the tools and gave the extraordinary opportunity to breathe life into inanimate objects, we thank you. For creating a place like no other on earth, full of the message of hope and essential goodness that drew on the best in all of these artists, we thank you. From all the children and from the child and every adult you touched and gave voice to, we thank you. We shall not look upon your like again, but like every great artist, you will always be with us in the work. A work so filled with joy and optimism, a work so filled with the belief in the eventual triumph of the creative spirit over all else, that like all great art, it reminds us that we each have our own capacity for triumph and brings us all a little closer to the angels. For this, Jim, we love you.
My name is Jerry Nelson. I started out to be a folk singer, maybe an actor. Jim gave me a chance to be all those things and many, many more. Not only in that area of my life, but in all areas of my life. I would like to have Floyd read something for you. Fearless leader, Dr. Dog Toothsome Piano Man, playing your joyous song of is, was, and will be, remembering always the fun, silly poop, 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 Bert. Fearless leader, Mr. Hands Open Wide, sharing insights of joy and love. Here, will you sip? Will you feast? There's plenty for all. Fearless leader, Whim of Steel, you've convinced me convincing, John. Cantus, I hear your magic flute whispering and echoing through the caves of my imagination. Fearless leader, green flippered gentleness, fill my dreams with your vision of unexplored possibilities. Shine on eternally bright in our hearts and minds. Fearless leader.
I might have known if God had granted me a son. Thank you.
Jim Henson's spirit, religiously, was as broad and as deep as his love of all of God's creation. And the family has asked that we have some readings from the holy traditions of the human family that again are broad, that represent us all. So the first is from the Rig Veda of the Hindu scriptures. O God, let us be united. Let us speak in harmony. Let our minds apprehend alike. Common be our prayer. Common be the end of our assembly. Common be our resolution. Common be our deliberations. Alike be our feelings. Unified be our hearts. Common be our intentions. Perfect be our unity. And this wonderful, very short reading from the Buddha. Now may every living thing, young or old, weak or strong, living near or far, known or unknown, living or departed or yet unborn, may every living thing be full of bliss. And this is from the Revelation of St. John the Divine. After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude, which no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God, who sits upon the throne, and to the Lamb. And all the angels stood round the throne and round the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, Who are these clothed in white robes, and whence have they come? I said to him, Sir, you know. And he said to me, These are they who have come out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, are they before the throne of God and serve him day and night within his temple. And he who sits upon the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes.
Let us begin this part of our time together in silence. I ask each one of you to think of Jim and cherish the images and memories in your mind. It's an honor to have been asked to be here. I'm Bishop Moore. Honored to be asked by Jane and Brian and John and Cheryl and Lisa and Heather to take part in this service because I never knew Jim. But being here today feels as close to being in the kingdom. The kingdom of love, the kingdom of heaven, as I've almost ever felt it here in this holy place. Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a tiny grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field. As a seed, it is the smallest of them all. But it grows to be the biggest of all plants, becomes a tree, big enough even for birds to come and nest in its branches." Jim was such a man who planted this seed. We've heard tonight, today, how it has grown, and there's a very big bird perched in its branches. We're here because of a person who could take what was a tiny idea, that seed of mustard, an idea which I guess started just with playfulness, and now that seed has grown and the wonder spreads across the world. And we see and feel today not only the widening circles of his family and friend here, but the circles going out and out and out and finally encompassing the whole circle of the world and coming back again, clustering around those awesome Muppets. They say the medium is a message. What mediums and what a message. Strange medium for such an overwhelming message. Strange creatures. But you know, it shows that the truth can be shown forth in any medium as long as that medium is love. And that therefore truth and love are one, which Jim showed us so clearly and so beautifully over so long. And so it was that Jim and Jane and all the rest of you here, and hundreds of others who couldn't be here tonight, extended and communicated that word of love and truth throughout the world. A friend of mine who's here put it this way, Naj. He said he took a bit of foam and wrapped it in a bit of bright cloth and added some buttons and stitched it together to create excitement and sadness and joy and comfort and all the ups and downs of life. And it was fun and it was funny and playful and loving. The greatest miracle of all, as far as I can see, is that the good guys are more interesting than the bad guys. Usually it's the other way around, as you know. The very few people in the world who've ever been able to make goodness that attractive. Jesus did. And he was playful and funny, although the translation and tradition of the Bible has almost wiped out his sense of humor, but... But think of his telling the people about that silly old lady bending over with her great big behind looking for the coin that she lost in the floor. And all those other wonderful parables were really very, very funny. And so those who knew and have known Jesus perhaps the most intimately over the years have depicted him as a clown, Christ the clown, the joyful, playful clown with tears streaming often down his face. And then there was Francis the troubadour, who called his body Brother Ass and seemed to love everything so much that he called poverty Lady Poverty. Well, these were the people who knew God, and they know and knew that the kingdom of God isn't solemn, nor does it, on the other hand, take life lightly. It's a delicate spirit of playfulness and passion. And this we call the Holy Spirit. Jim Henson once wrote that when things were going well for him, ideas just sort of appeared and came into his mind, hundreds and hundreds of ideas that you all have spoken of this afternoon. And it seems to me that this means that he was connected with that mystery that some of us call God, and some of us have no name for. Somehow he was connected. And this holiness, this playful passion, came down through that wonderful brain and personality of his, and then spread out through the world that needs it now so much. A world that is just on the edge today of bursting into the flowers of freedom for the first time in centuries, or destroying itself. Jim has given the love so that the world will flower into that freedom. Well, why then, why should this wonderful, wonderful man be taken away from us seemingly? Why? His family. Heard the tears right here. Well, there isn't any answer, really. Because the God that Jim believes in, and I and you do, is not a God that will want to hurt anybody any more than the big bird would. Doesn't want to hurt anybody, but hurt is there. So God shares that hurt. As I think, for all his playfulness, Jim seems to have. And because God shares it on the cross, to use that symbol, or the suffering servant in the Old Testament, it's bearable. Because he bears it with us, otherwise we couldn't. And so you gotta look at it this way. It seems to me that dying is just as much a part of life as living, and that there's a wonderful rhythm in the world that, again, Jim caught so well. And this is a rhythm of dying and rising, of dying and rising. And there can never be a rising if there hasn't been a dying. can never be a birth if there hasn't been a borning. And so part of it is this wonderful, lovely business of winter and spring and summer and fall and dying and rising. And Jim's dying is part of that, a beautiful part of that. And he also left a gift for all of us that we would be allowed to remember him in his prime, saying this yesterday to Jane, somebody young dies, part of that is so wonderful that you always remember them in all their glory. And not as some dried up shadow of their former self. So he gave us that by going so soon. We can say all this, but I know that there's some real dark, hurting places deep inside you. Very dark. And I pray that God's love will be in there, in that little dark place with you, and will gradually allow you to come out of that darkness and remember the joy and not the pain. And God's love will heal that pain. Because, you know, this is the ultimate wonder, that you would not be in pain if you didn't love him so much. But you wouldn't trade 1 ounce of that love to relieve the pain. So, let's celebrate, go on and continue to celebrate that wonderful heritage that Kermit the Frog and the others has spread throughout the world by dropping these mustard seeds that will grow up into the trees for all the big birds of life. Celebrate this, knowing that underneath is sorrow and grief and pain, but that ultimately and most gloriously it is resurrection and new life, and all that love and playfulness and joy going out through the world. So stand up, embrace one another with love, thinking of Jim. God bless you. Embrace.
These are Jim's beautiful children. Brian. Heather. Heather. Lisa. John. Cheryl. Whom he loved completely and was exceedingly proud. I didn't plan to say anything. I haven't made any plans, so I'm just going to say things that I've thought about as I've been listening. There are people I want to thank. Louise, with her beautiful voice, was not able to introduce herself, so I need to tell you her name, Louise Gold, who we love, from England. With us on the Muppet Show. We've always adored her voice. The transcending music, Paul Williams. When we'd listen to his music, we always were lifted from earth and above the earth and over to all the other places. And Jim loved that feeling. And the song sounds so right here now. I did ask for a lot of flowers. And they come from Connie, our corner florist. Each flower is chosen because it's a perfect flower, designed by a perfect designer. Each flower holds a complete message that Jim would ever want to share with you. It's beauty, it's perfection, it's differences, it's beginning and it's end, and re-beginning. I don't want to pretend that I know what happens after this life, or that Jim really knew what would happen after this life, but he had great plans. And I sure hope somebody lets him know we're doing this down here, because he's probably pretty busy. On to the next. I'd like to let you know a little bit about who he thinks he's going to be working with now. Don Celine, who built the Sesame puppets and built Burr Tillstrom's puppets, and Burr Tillstrom. Oh, God. Bill Baird, Rufus Rose. I'm sorry if I'm going to forget people. I don't know. Joe Pozo. But maybe more than anything else, his mother, his brother that he lost a lot of years ago, was very anxious to get back to, and his grandmother, his mother's mother, who he always credited as being his greatest inspiration. He's stayed with us long enough to give us certainly all that we need if we're strong enough to carry on, but I'm sure he wanted to go on with enthusiasm to the next work. Mostly I think now, I just feel like it's only us, his family. These are only his kids. I'm only his wife. They had messy rooms, I burned the dinner. He didn't come home. The dog died, whatever. All the stuff. It's only us. And I know sometimes, because everybody else was working, I would be used for interviews, and the press would ask me, did you ever have any idea that it would get this big? And what I didn't know is that it had gotten this big. I just didn't know. So I'm very grateful for everyone who's come here. And I know that the reason you're touched is because Jim touched some special place in you that knows all the delight and all the truth and all the love that there is to know. And I hope that you'll take whatever he's given you and let it help you to enjoy life to the fullest, because he always did, but always with a little pain, a little sorrow that gave it richness. Thank you.
I'm Cheryl, and I wanted to read a little bit from a piece that my father wrote a couple of years ago. He was asked to write about his beliefs, and he worked on it for a bit, and he came up with some really very wonderful things. Just a couple of them. He says, "I believe in taking a positive attitude towards the world, toward people, and toward my work. I think I'm here for a purpose. I think it's likely that we all are, but I'm only sure about myself. I try to tune myself into whatever it is that I'm supposed to be, and I try to think of myself as a part of all of us, all mankind and all of life. I don't know exactly where ideas come from, but when I'm working well, ideas just appear. I've heard other people say similar things, so it's one of the ways that I know that there is help and guidance out there. It's just a matter of us figuring out how to receive the ideas or the information that's there waiting to be heard." He writes, "When I was young, my ambition was to be one of the people who makes a difference in this world. My hope still is to leave this world a little bit better than it was when I got here. It's a wonderful life, and I love it." And we all love him very, very much. That's my bit.
I'm Brian. When my father died, he left each one of us a letter, and it helped us a lot, and I think we'd like to share it, parts of it, to all of you. He wrote this about 4 years ago. We received it 3 days ago. "I'm not at all afraid of the thought of death, and in many ways look forward to it with much curiosity and interest. I'm looking forward to meeting up with some of my friends who've gone on ahead of me, and I'll be waiting there to say hi to those of you who are still back there. I suggest you first have a nice, friendly little service of some kind." Sorry, Dad, little service, big place. "It would be lovely if some of the people who sing would do a song or two, some of which should be quite happy and joyful. It would be nice if some of my close friends would say a few nice, happy words about how much we enjoy doing this stuff together. Incidentally, I'd love to have a Dixieland band play at this function and end with a rousing version of Saints. So you have that to look forward to." He finished this letter. This was addressed to friends and family. "Have a wonderful time in life, everybody. It feels strange writing this kind of thing while I'm still alive, but it wouldn't be easy to do after I go." There was also a letter specifically from him to the kids, to us five. And I would like to read a little bit out of that as well. These are just excerpts. "First of all, don't feel bad that I'm gone. While I will miss spending time with each of you, I'm sure it will be an interesting time for me, and I look forward to seeing all of you when you come over. To each of you, I send my love. If on this side of life I'm able to watch over and help you out, know that I will. If I can't, I'm sure I can at least be waiting for you when you come over. Please watch out for each other and love and forgive everybody. It's a good life. Enjoy it. This all may sound silly and over the top to you guys, but what the hell? I'm gone, and who can argue with me?
I hope that you enjoy the pictures that are in the back that John and the people in the company have worked on. And I'm so impressed with our group and the people who have been working, the people who created his extended creative family who have worked on this, and the outpouring of effort and love. And I don't want to say thank you because I know it's not for me, but I really appreciate it.
Family, that's the key word. I think we've all realized that. Today, started with Jim. He believed in Jane. Through their love, they were able to bring us five more beautiful human beings who learned to believe in themselves. And it was great to see all the kids that are here today interspersed amongst us, little kids clutching their Ernies and their Berts and their big birds. It was so nice to see that some parents realize this is as much for them as it is for us. And it is. Jim had doubts of his own. Sometimes he'd go, what do we do now? Bernie would say, I don't know. But fortunately, he had one very strong friend who stood by him through all the hard times of the last 15 years. His name is David Laser. And David was always there to say, no, this is right. This is right. Is it going to work? Trust me, hey. They're gonna have us all over the world. Yeah. He made Jim remind himself to believe in himself as well. Because it takes an enormous amount of belief every single day of our lives. I wish there was some way to get rid of this pain that we're all feeling, this enormous sadness that we all feel. But there are no words. There's nothing any of us can tell each other except to be there, to support, to love, to have someone to hug. And it takes time. Sometimes lots of time, each unto his own. But there is solace and there is joy to know that Jim has returned home for a little while, and that all of us are going to go back there someday. The spirit of Jim was here before, during, and remains after his stay. And hopefully that part of him that we each keep will help us remind us to stop rushing, stop trying to control things, instead to experience the wonder that God has given us through this vastness, this divinity, this oneness, this being that we all share with all living things, with the animals, most especially for me, the singing birds. There's nothing I like better than to stop for a moment, turn off a car, walk out into the woods, and just sit and listen to those guys sing. Not bad. the flowers, the irises, the lilacs, and the peonies, my favorite flower. Go up and smell the richness of their aroma and their fragrance. The earth, you can feel it under us. We have this thing called gravity that pulls us to the earth. And here we are feeling this enormous planet support all of us and help sustain us. The sun, the warmth of the sun, the light as it shines through a piece of colored glass. The stars that we look up and wonder and say, is that where we're going? And most especially, the smile and the laughter of the children. And if perchance somewhere down the line you see a child who, when you speak to him and ask him a question, he says, possibly, maybe, Watch out, because there's more magic to come. Jim did not cling to the past. He did not worry about the future. That would work itself out. And he did not live for the moment. Instead, he lived in the moment. Because that's all we really have. It's important that we all stop giving ourselves such a hard time. We've got to remind ourselves and push ourselves to let go. There's not much we can do except be, and in being, become aware. See what's going on around you all the time and allow it to happen. All the sadness, all the joy. And that's why Jim's last words are most important. Please watch out for each other, he says. Love everyone and forgive everyone, including yourself. Forgive your anger, forgive your guilt, your shame, your sadness. Embrace and open up your love, your joy, your truth, and most especially your heart. Let us all have mercy on each and every one of us. And every day, we will open up like a cocoon and turn into beautiful butterflies and live this moment and the next and the next and the next. One of Jim's favorite times in any production was the musical pre-record session. When he and his performers, including me, would gather in the relaxed atmosphere of a recording studio to lay down the vocal tracks, we would have a great time. Right now, we'd like to share that moment with you as some of the Muppet performers sing some of Jim's favorite songs.
Beside it, though. Lydia, say, have you met Lydia? Oh, Lydia, the champ of them all. She once swept an admiral clear off his feet. The ships on her hips made his heart skip a beat. And now the old boy's in command of the fleet. For he went and married Lydia. La la la.
It's in every one of us to be wise. Find your heart, open up both your eyes. We can all know everything without ever.
Okay, Fozzie?
Yes!
I may go out tomorrow if I can borrow a coat to wear.
Why not?
Oh, I'd step out in style with my sincere smile and my dancing bear.
Yes.
Outrageous.
Aha!
Alarming.
Yes, it is.
Courageous.
And charming.
Yes. Oh, who would think a boy and bear could be well accepted everywhere? It's just amazing how good people can be.
Very good, Skitter.
Thank you very much, Fozzie, but I have to do another verse.
Go ahead.
Seen at the nicest faces where well-fed faces all stop to stare.
Uh-huh.
Making the grandest entrance is Simon Smith and his dancing bear.
They'll love us, won't they?
Sure.
They feed us, don't they?
Maybe, oh, who would think a boy and bear could be well accepted everywhere? It's just amazing how fair people can be. Tell them like it is, Foz.
Who needs money when you're funny?
The greatest traction everywhere will be Simon Smith and his dancing bear. It's Simon Smith and the amazing dancing bear.
Was I all right?
You were great.
Thank you.
Halfway down the stairs is a stair where I sit. There isn't any other stair quite like it. I'm not at the bottom, I'm not at the top. So this is the stair where I always stop. Halfway up the stairs isn't up and isn't down. It isn't in the nursery, it isn't in the town. And all sorts of funny thoughts run round my head. It isn't really any place, it's somewhere else instead. Halfway up the stairs is a stair where I sit. There isn't any other stair quite like it. I'm not at the bottom, I'm not at the top. So this is the stair where I always stop.
Cuddleston, Cuddleston pie. A fly can't bird, but a bird can fly. Ask me a riddle and I reply. Cuddleston, Cuddleston, Cuddleston pie. Cuddleston, 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 Cuddleston Pie. A fish can't whistle, and neither can I. Ask me a riddle, and I reply, Cuddleston, Cuddleston, Cuddleston Pie. Woo! Cuddleston, Cuddleston, Cuddleston Pie. Why does that chicken? I don't know why. Ask me a riddle, and I reply, Cuddleston, Cuddleston, Cuddleston Pie.
This looks familiar, vaguely familiar, almost unreal yet. It's too soon to feel yet, close to my soul, and yet so far away. I'm going to go back there someday. Sun rises, night falls, sometimes the sky calls. Is that a song there? And do I belong there? I've never been there, but I know the way. I'm going to go back there someday. Come and go with me, it's more fun to share. We'll both be completely at home in midair. We're flying, not walking, on featherless wings. We can hold on to love like invisible strings. There's not a word yet for old friends who've just met. Part heaven, part space, or have I found my place? You can just visit, but I plan to stay. I'm going to go back there someday. I'm going to go back there someday.
Well, when I'm Wimbling West, I take the friend I like best, and we just wimble, wimble, wimble side by side.
And when we're Wimbling South, we stick our feet in our mouth,
and we just wimble, wimble, wimble as we ride. So now it's doodle 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 doodle. Just the Wimbling song can't go wrong. Yeah, it's just doodle 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 doodle.
Just wimble along.
We wimble most to the east, but north we wimble the least. We wimble, wimble, wimble all along. Come on and wimble, and you'll be just a Wimbling fool.
Cause that's the
wimble, womble, wimble thing. Yeah, we just wimble doodle doodle doodle. The Wimbling song can't go wrong. Yeah, it's a
squid, squiddly, squat, squat, doodly, wop, wop, doodly, doo.
Just Wimbling on, just Wimbling on, just Wimbling on.
You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. The other night, dear, as I lay sleeping, I dreamed I held you in my arms. When I awoke, dear, I was mistaken, and I hung my head and cried. You are my sunshine, my only sunshine. You make me happy when skies are gray. You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away. don't take my sunshine away.
If just one person believes in you, deep enough and strong enough believes in you, hard enough and long enough, before you knew it, someone else would think, if he can do it, I can do it. Making it
two whole people who believe in you,
deep enough and strong enough believe in you, hard enough and long enough, there's bound to be some other person who believes in making it a threesome,
making it three.
People, you can say, believe in me. And if three whole people, why not four? And if four whole people, why not more and more and more? And when all those people believe in you, deep enough and strong enough believe in you, hard enough and long enough, it stands to reason you yourself would start to
into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Jim. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of all the saints in light. Amen.
Unto God's gracious mercy and protection we commit you. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace and joy and love today and forevermore. Amen.